join me for the flag salute.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Bless us, Lord, as we gather today for this Freeholder meeting. Guide our minds and our hearts so we may work together for the good of our community. Help us to be generous in our outlook, courageous in the face of difficulty, and wise in our decisions. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
In compliance with the Open Public Meetings Act, this is to announce that adequate notice of this meeting has been provided. Also, pursuant to the 2016 bylaws, rules, and regulations of the Board of Chosen Freeholders of the County of Burlington, time shall be set aside on the agenda for the receipt of public comments. Public comments will be received with respect to agenda items prior to board consideration of resolutions to be adopted. An additional opportunity for public comment will occur later in the meeting. Public comment shall be limited to 5 minutes per speaker. Unused time may not be transferred to another speaker. Persons may speak once per public comment period. I direct the deputy clerk to enter into the minutes of this meeting this public announcement and the advance written notice of this meeting. Freeholder Donnelly.
Here.
Freeholder Gibbs.
Here.
Freeholder O'Brien.
Here.
Freeholder Peters.
Present.
And Director O'Brien.
Here.
Of Gargano. Sorry.
All right, we're looking for a motion to approve the minutes of the reorg of January 4th and the meeting of January 13th.
So moved.
Motion by Freeholder O'Brien, second.
Second.
Second by Freeholder Peters. Questions or additions? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? At this point, we'll move on to our recognitions. John Banks. First of all, congratulations on your retirement.
Thank you very much.
It's well earned. 25 years?
25.
25 years. God bless you. And what we have here is we have a certificate of appreciation for yourself, and then we have the clock.
Paper clock.
You know what? I'm going to let you take it out of the clock because I'll probably drop it. Did we give him a battery? All right, we'll get you a battery too.
Well, do you want to get there? We'll take a picture. Great.
Oh,
there you go. Sure.
There we go.
There you are. Great. Thank you very much.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
It's been an honor.
Thank you.
Same here.
Board, it's been a pleasure.
Thank you, sir.
Congratulations.
And then we have Eva Malak. Good. Now, you're a 29-year.
Actually 32, but that's
fine. Oops. Congratulations, and we do appreciate your service over that time.
Thank you. I enjoyed it.
And we'll get you the clock, and I promise we'll get you a fresh battery.
Yeah, all right, folks? You might have been.
Yeah.
Great. Great. Thank you.
Thank you.
At this point, we move on to public comment on agenda items. I have a large list here tonight that looks like it's tied to things that probably aren't agenda items. So I'm just going to start. If you wanted to speak about an agenda item, please come forward, and then we'll see what we have. Agenda item?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Hello, how are you?
Hello.
I've got one agenda item and
public comment for later. The question I have is regarding I-15 about the Fork Landing Bridge. The bridge on Fork Landing Road. The replacement of that bridge, is that something, how long would that replacement last? Is there a prognosis for how, is that a short-term replacement? Is that something that is going to be for 5 years, 10 years? What's the status of that?
It's designed a complete replacement of the bridge.
Completely.
Life expectancy of a complete replacement.
And how that'd be. Hopefully 40, 50 years.
Okay.
All right,
thank you.
Then
I
just
have public comment for when
you
start.
Thank you.
Anyone else on agenda items?
Good evening. My name is Louis Lopez from Mount Holly, from Mount Holly, for question, I will do your agenda item. And the first one is I-2. I-5, I-11,
I-2 and I-5 are basically a recent refinancing county debt. You know, right at this point we have the ability to go at a lower rate, you know, with the way the rates are, so we're taking advantage of that. So that basically retired both of those. Your other one was I-11?
Yes.
That is, it's a shared service agreement between municipalities. There's an agreement that they do some of our roads that they would rather take care of in their communities. So that's basically a shared service agreement between the county and some of our municipalities.
Then the last one is, I got some other clever to speak. Thank you.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Anyone else on agenda items? Seeing none, we will move on to resolutions. I'd like to make a motion to approve resolutions I-1 through I-7 by unanimous consent.
Second.
Motion by Gargano, second by O'Brien. Questions? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstentions?
Abstention with regard to I-1, page 22, Colonial Village.
Thank you, Freeholder.
Thank you.
Freeholder Gitch.
Thank you, Director. Before we vote on these items, I'd like to take a minute to explain the action we are taking with item I-8. On Monday, a meeting of New Jersey College presidents voted against a proposal that would allow two-year colleges to offer bachelor's degrees in nursing, sending the ultimate decision to Higher Education Secretary Rochelle Hendricks. The reality is that the ground has shifted under those students who wish to pursue a career in nursing, with even most entry-level jobs now requiring a bachelor's degree as compared to an associate's degree. Unfortunately, the cost of most four-year bachelor degree programs total upwards of $45,000, a steep financial burden that many students simply cannot afford. These students should not be relegated to hourly work and excluded from rewarding careers that can pay $90,000 a year simply because they cannot afford the ballooning costs of college. Allowing our community colleges to offer bachelor degree programs in this important field will save students and their families money, reduce student loan debt, and result in more well-trained nurses in good, high-paying jobs that are available in our region. Opportunities like this should not be fought, but embraced. That is what we've done here in Burlington County and what our new Workforce Development Institute is all about. That is why, as a member of the RCBC Board of Trustees, I worked with President Drayton to spearhead that effort and our new partnership with Rowan University, and why we as a Freeholder Board remain committed to seeing those efforts succeed. Together, this board and the college are setting a national model for improving access to affordable higher education and meaningful employment opportunities. For the sake of all of our students here in Burlington County and throughout the state, we urge Secretary Hendricks and the President's Council to follow our lead. The resolution I am asking us to vote on tonight does just that. In the days ahead, I will reach out to our fellow freeholders across the state and ask them to join us in this resolution to send a unified message of support for accessible and affordable higher education for all students. Thank you, and with that, I'd like to make a motion to move items I-8 through I-17 by unanimous consent.
Motion by Freeholder Gibbs, second by Freeholder O'Brien. Questions? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it. Freeholder O'Brien.
Mr. Director, at this time, I'd like to move resolutions I-18 through I-20 for unanimous consent.
Second. Motion by Freeholder O'Brien, second by Freeholder Donnelly. Questions? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Freeholder Peters.
Mr. Director, I'd like to move resolutions I-21 and I-22 by unanimous consent.
Second.
Motion by Freeholder Peters, second by Freeholder O'Brien. Questions? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? We'll move on to item J, which is questions from the press. And we'll move on to public comment. This is the part of the meeting where you get to have, you know, anything you'd like to discuss. I have about 10 or 12 names here, so I'm just going to go from one through, and then we'll open the doors up again if anybody else would like to talk besides the first group. Mr. Milanis.
Yes, sir.
You're number one. Name and address, sir.
West Hampton, 604 Ford Drive. <clears throat> 60 years ago, they bring me to fight in Korea and Vietnam. And I got a piece of paper with the president honor the Buccaneers in Puerto Rico 60 years later. And what I tried to do, we got, I think, military retired, a couple million in the Burlington County and the area. And I'm making that memorial in West Hampton to recognize the people that never came home, disappeared, never came home. Now, I want to add to that the Buccaneers. Believe it or not, we fight. I think we did a good job in Korea, but nobody cares, you know. The only time I say somebody say thank you for serving our country, but that's it. When I came from Vietnam, they spit on my face. And the only thing I tried to do, the Buccaneers, I'm probably the last one of them, because most everybody's dead now. But they got the families, they settle around West Hampton, Mount Holly, Willingboro, the whole area, Mammoth. And I like to do something to that memorial that I make in West Hampton to add to the Buccaneers there. And I need you help if you can. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you for your service.
Thank you.
Selka.
Martha Vasalka, 34 Saw Road. Hello. I'm here to oppose the compressor station and pipeline. And I'm going to talk about two things: safety and alternate energy. To learn more about compressor stations, I bought the book Fundamentals of Natural Gas Processing. I am an engineer, so I'm trying to learn a little bit more. I will just go through the safety concerns that I found in this book. In most every chapter, I'll just list a couple chapters because, and then I'll go on to alternate energy. All right, safety concerns for field operations and inlet receiving at a compressor station. Leaky pipelines, danger of ignition from hydrogen sulfides. Plugged pipelines, solid blockage or stuck pig in the pipeline. It's cleared by blowdown, and when you have a blowdown, that's when all the gases, those benzenes, nitrous gases go in the air that can hurt the people around the compressor station. Next safety concern area is the compression, the actual act of compressing gas. Apart from the dangers inherent in high pressure, high-temperature equipment, and high-temperature equipment, noise is a main safety concern, 85 to 95 dB. All right, the next section is gas treating. the big environmental concern here is hydrogen sulfide leakage in plants, and you want to make sure you reclaim the waste. So that's about all I'm going to say as far as the damages, the safety concerns with the compressor station. The issue is, if something does happen, who is going to protect the citizens? You know, now that gas prices are so low, will Transco still be in business? Or will New Jersey Gas still be in business? Who is going to help pay people if there is a major disaster? Don't know. Alternates to this are renewable energy. With our state crisscrossed with almost at 100% capacity with natural gas pipelines, there is no room for renewable energy. Renewable energy supports businesses in Burlington County, like Lockheed Martin, Tidal Turbine. They are working on programs of Tidal Turbine where you harvest energy from the ocean. And if we are fully built out with gas, there'll be no need for us to invest or have these renewable energies. Other companies provide their equipment and services to Lockheed Martin, like Trek Connect, that's a company I work for, like Radwell, and those two companies are right down here on my Holly Bypass. There's a lot of jobs that are associated with this renewable energy, and we should be supporting that and promoting it, and not giving it a kick in the pants by overbuilding with natural gas. Okay, next, and I will give this to you guys so you can have it. Next is ocean thermal energy conversion. This is where you take, it's like a pipe in the water, and you take the hot water from the top of the ocean and the cold water from the bottom of the ocean, and it meets and it creates steam. And this is another way of generating energy, and these are new ways of generating energy without using fossil fuels, and they're renewable. The last energy I'm going to be talking about is bobbing for power. This is also a company that's in New Jersey. It's based in Pennington, New Jersey, and it's called Offshore Power Technology. And it uses the tides, the movement of the tides, to create energy. This is just what I found based off the ocean, because this is where I believe that this natural gas is going. So I would rather have this renewable ocean type renewable and energy rather than what is going to happen when the gas lines are in. And that is liquefied natural gas stations and gas storage. And we all know what happens with gas storage. That's what's happening in California right now. So for these reasons, I am against this pipeline, among many others. And I'd like to just give you this, and this is on the renewables. And I ask that you oppose the pipeline and the compressor station. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Pete Caruso.
Hello.
Hello.
I want to start by asking one question, and I'm fairly confident that we are all going to have the same response. My one question to all of you here in the committee and in the audience: what is your most important, meaningful, and rewarding job? I'm not here as a scientist, I'm not here as an environmentalist, or a politician. I am here as a parent. And I am part of the Responsible Pipeline Group, and we are all opposing the compressor station and pipeline. It is our goal as parents, and maybe some of you in the audience grandparents, to protect our children at whatever cost we can from this potential disaster of the pipeline and compressor station. Maybe you can help me answer this question. When my husband sits at the top of our driveway, as he has done for the past 19 years, our older two are in college and my youngest is 15, and says, "What is going to happen if this pipeline explodes, Dad, while we're waiting for the bus?" I think we all know the terrifying answer to this question, if we're all honest about it. When I was told last year there was a 30% chance that I had cancer, I had to rephrase that in my mind and turn it into a positive. There's a 70% chance that I'm going to be healthy and I'm going to beat this. And that's how I feel with this compressor station and pipeline. A lot of people think this is a done deal. There's nothing we should do. We should just throw up our hands and say we can't fight this. Together we do have power. We do have a lot of strength. And together we can make a difference. So we're asking you to join us in opposing the compressor station and the pipeline. I also brought a letter, and I'm not sure if it's in our binder or not, but last week there was a large forum in Bordentown, organized by the Bordentown mayor, who did a wonderful job, and other people helping her. And one of the letters that we received it was signed by Senator Thompson, Assemblyman Dancer, and Assemblyman Robert Clifton. And it was written to Norman Bay, the chairman of FERC. And basically, these three politicians have joined in writing on behalf of our constituents in Chesterfield and other townships about all of the inaccuracies stated in FERC's environmental assessment. And examples of these include the statement that there are no public or private wells within 150 feet up to 1 mile of the site. Most everyone along the compressor station and route have wells. Secondly, based on the documentation, there is no certainty that the commission issued a notice of intent to all affected landowners within 0.5 miles of the compressor station. Why did the section on air emissions impact and mitigation only list construction emissions? So they're urging FERC to look at the negative impacts. And I have all of the numbers for the legislation, so I don't know if you have this or not, but I would like to give you this. I brought this. We have collected approximately 5,000 petitions thus far. A small group of people that is growing. So 5,000 in here, and just last week at the two-hour forum, we collected close to 500. So we do have strength, and we do have power, and we do have the ability to prevent this disaster from happening. But we really need everyone to help and support this, because there are a lot of other resources besides natural gas that's not even needed in this area. I work for a school. I'm a school psychologist, so we had a snow day on Monday. I chose to contact a couple attorneys in Washington, D.C., and it was interesting that one of them referred to New Jersey as the state with nest of pipelines, that this is what our state is being known for, to have nests of pipelines. And I was told by this attorney that FERC needs to realize at some point that these pipelines and compressor stations are just not necessary. So with that, I'd like to leave this for you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Yes.
First, I want to thank everybody for coming out tonight. But I think I've been handed the flyer that I think brought many of you here tonight. I think it has a little bit of misinformation that hopefully I can clear up for you. Maybe answer some of your questions as you come in for public comment. So, in regards to the Southern Reliability Pipeline, that's being proposed by New Jersey Natural Gas. Both as a candidate, now being sworn in, I've watched this issue closely. I actually remember, I see a lot of familiar faces. I was there at RCBC at the big area there. Where we stayed there for probably 3 hours, some of you, I think. I see one of you who was there with me until about 9:30 or 10. Speaking out against the pipeline and moving it, the alternative route. Now, we as freeholders, we don't have a vote yes or no on the pipeline. That's not up to us. That's the legislatures and the governors. But what we have done is we've made an alternative route that doesn't go through the county roads 528 and 664. That route that we spoke about at RCBC that night, which many of you remember, was developed by the county engineers at the direction of this board. So that alternative route that goes away from your houses and small business towns, that was developed by the county engineers at the direction of this board. Unfortunately, the Board of Public Utilities did not accept that route. And we continue to act against the current route, and we're proponents for the alternative route that we developed. So if the legislature or the governor decides to act, they do have a viable alternative to getting away from the houses, your front yards. I think the young woman just spoke about your husband on the driveway. The alternative route wouldn't go through that. As for the compression station, we have, as it says in the flyer, we have decided to endorse that. That is categorically false, and under no circumstances have we endorsed that. What we've said is the compressor system is a matter of home rule, meaning we proposed the alternative route when it went through county roads, but we do not have any jurisdiction or any sort of home rule problems in that compressor station. We're leading up to the towns who are involved where the land is actually situated. So we did not endorse it. That was when the flyer, it's not true. And I think the unfortunate part was the flyer that brought you here did you, I think, a really horrible disservice in the sense that we don't have jurisdiction over this. This is for the BPU, state legislatures, and governors, and they actually had a meeting this afternoon to decide the issue. They took public comment, and they ruled on it this afternoon. And unfortunately, no one maybe told you about that, or you knew about it and didn't go, but you're here, and we can't. They could have this afternoon, we can't tonight. So I apologize that you were given that information, and look forward to more comment, but hopefully that's more clarifying information for you. Thank you.
Thank you, Freeholder. Barbara Fox Cooper.
Barbara Fox Cooper, River Freehold Township, Monmouth County. Some of us are aware, we just were aware a few minutes ago of that ruling.
Correct.
But we're here to further encourage you to do whatever you can, because we don't feel the fight is over. Upper Freehold Township last April was confronted by New Jersey Natural Gas, and as you may know, they caved to a lawsuit. And so what they did is they moved the pipeline from the center of town to the outskirts of town. It affected as many people in the outskirts of town as it did in the middle of town. When we went to Monmouth County, they said, too, that they voted in alignment with home rule. Upper Freehold Township, 3 weeks ago, rescinded the former support of the pipeline. They filed resolution 67-16 opposing the pipeline. We went back to Monmouth County 1 week ago. Monmouth County is now filing a resolution opposing not only the pipeline, the compressor station as well. Just want to bring you up to date. Since you are county level freeholders, this is how it progressed for Monmouth County. Number two, we did have a forum a couple weeks ago, a week ago, was it? And former and current mayors from Bordentown, Chesterfield, and North Hanover attended. But also in attendance was Senator Diane Allen, Assemblyman Conway, Dancer, and Singleton, and Senator Cory Booksade. At the conclusion of our forum, presentations were given by Sierra Club, Food and Water, Pinelands Preservation, Rethink Energy, and a few others. But at the conclusion of the forum, these people that I mentioned, the senator, the assemblyman, and so forth, said, number one, that they learned a lot that night that they didn't know before. Number two, that they had never seen such a well-organized, well-attended, professional, passionate group of people about a project. And number three, every single one of them committed their support to join us in opposition of the pipeline. So I share that information with you to encourage you to find a way. We do not feel it's over. BPU ruled yes, but we still don't feel that it's over. Thank you.
Thank you. That's a pretty good legislative delegation that was present
I'm assuming they also committed to crafting and getting the legislation necessary to get the alternative route approved?
Yes, no.
No, not an alternative route.
Stop it.
We've moved the campaign. We no longer sponsor moving the pipeline. It's stop the pipeline. Originally, UFT, Upper Freehold Township, supported moving the pipeline.
I'm more concerned about the legislators. What did they say?
They committed to stopping the pipeline, not moving it. Each and every one of the people I mentioned.
And the station.
And the compressor station. Thank you.
Sir, from Montauk, first question, have there been any cases of Zika mosquito virus in Burlington County?
Mosquito virus?
Yeah,
Zika virus?
Yeah.
No.
I think Arkansas or something.
I want to tell you, what's the difference between that virus and the rest of the virus? I mean,
we could already get you that information off the top of our heads. I don't think we're medical folks up here, but Holly's back there. Holly, could you explain the difference between the viruses?
For Zika virus and which other one?
The West Nile virus.
The West Nile. They're both mosquito-borne diseases. However, who they affect is different. Anybody can truly be affected by West Nile. Zika really only affects right now babies while they're in utero. When they're born, they have a birth defect.
I've been seeing a lot of friends in New York. What the guy says doing about this? I live in Belton County, I mean, over in South America, by Colombia, it's almost like between 1 and 5, you know, go to the hospital. Mostly affecting pregnant ladies, but people who, and my second comment is one thing to our war veteran, Mr. Menadas, who coming, supporting it anyway. My order comment is, has Burlington County received any report of lead on the water system?
I don't think we have any reports of lead within our water systems.
No, we don't operate water systems.
Yeah, I mean, New Jersey, water does a lot. There's a lot of municipalities, but actually, there's reports that come out every year on every one of those water systems that lists all of the chemicals and contaminants that are in those systems, and I haven't seen anything that kicked up like that. If there is, they get addressed yearly. So I don't think you'd see what happened in Flint in our communities.
Well, in case of a matter that we went through water systems, who's in charge of the Board of American Water or the county or the state?
Well, the townships they do their own testing, and it gets reported to the state. I'm sure American Water does theirs. New Jersey Water does theirs. So there's a process that's set up in New Jersey where the systems have to be tested.
And my next question is for the state services. I wanted to thank the Freeholders. I think they did Manhattan Township some trucks. Is that true?
But they lent us trucks, or
trucks in Manhattan Township.
I know that if there's an issue, that we try to help any of our communities if we can. I'm not sure if there's.
I want to say, thank you for the support. I mean, the run of roads up there is a little bit tricky. I mean, that's why I said thank you. On the road, the county roads, ride bikes. People keep running in the middle of the road or next to the road. And my last is, it's the Senator Bridge with any status?
Joe, anything changed in the last 2 weeks on Senator?
Our consultant is dealing with all the regulatory agencies, Coast Guard, State Historic Preservation, DEP, and Army Corps of Engineers, and I should have something to report to the board in a few weeks.
And have been any cases for Code Blue?
Yes.
For about the last 7 or 8 days.
I don't think we're code blue right now.
Any changes?
Yeah. No, it's when the code blue comes in, we try to get as many people into shelters as we can.
Okay. And I wonder if everyone, you know, to see this video up to 9 minutes, 2 hours after I leave, but I'm not hardy, MUA. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Rita Romeo? Or Romea, did I mess it up?
Nope, Romeo was right.
Okay.
Very few people get it right. Thank you. I'm from Chesterfield, and I'm here just to talk a little bit about the health impacts of the pipeline and the compressor station. And again, you know, I don't want to rehash a lot of things that you've probably already heard. One of our other speakers, who's going to be up in a little bit, has prepared a binder for you. We have all sorts of articles and, you know, evidence about health risks of pipelines and compressor stations. Also, there's a lot of other good information in here with resolutions and other things for past, but I don't want to steal her thunder. But it's a great resource, and all of the legislators that we've given it to so far have been very impressed with it. So hopefully you'll look over that and, you know, study up on it. So that's good.
Can I see that? No?
No, okay. Not yet. She's going to give you yours. Sorry about the dress. Okay. There still remains a lot of concern among the residents of Burlington County about the health effects of the proposed compressor station and pipeline. I'm presently at the forum in Bordentown that a lot of the other speakers have talked about. There were a lot of discussions about natural gas pipelines, effects on the water tables and soil of various places. All gas pipelines do leak. You know, it's not anything, you know, condemning the people who put them in or whatever, but eventually they just do leak. This might take time, but it gets into the soil and water. I'm sure you might have read a lot of the articles recently about the leak in California on Porter Ranch. And not only are the people suffering ill effects from this leak, both in the air and the water, but so are the farm animals as well. So it is really affecting a lot of the farms, which of course Chesterfield, you know, does have a lot of farms. That brings me to one of my next points. Our agriculture board has decided to hold a special meeting in the next month or so. They decided this at their last meeting a couple weeks ago to really focus on this compressor station and pipeline, because they are worried about the impact it's going to have on several of the major farms in Chesterfield. You know, one of them at our forum, one of the farmers got up to speak. She owns the largest CSA in the county, maybe even the state. They've been in business for a number of years, providing, you know, organic food to over 400 people a week. They are extremely worried about, you know, what's going to happen, even in the construction phase, what that's going to do to, you know, their soil and possibly their water. It was very, very interesting because I used to belong to that farm, and, you know, who knows? You know, she's worried that all of a sudden they might not be organic anymore. So it's a real, you know, I think, fear among all the farmers, and that's our big business in Chesterfield, you know, and they just feel that it's bad for that business. So, you know, it'll remain to be seen what happens at this meeting, but I think it's going to be very interesting. Just to elaborate a little bit, because I was at a lot of these meetings that we were just talking about, that Barbara was just talking about the bipartisan support for opposition to the pipeline. I did go to the meeting with Assemblyman Dancer and Clifton. They asked, you know, us to reach out to Democrats in the area, you know, to support their bills opposing the pipeline. I said I would, and then lo and behold, it was much easier because they all showed up at the forum. And I especially was impressed by Representative Assemblyman Conaway, who's a physician, and he was very, very concerned about health risks and hence opposing this pipeline. I was in Senator Booker's office and Senator Menendez's office within the last 3 weeks as well, talking to them about some of these potential harmful effects. And they're very interested. You know, they want to do follow-up meetings with us, and, you know, they are very, very seriously interested in, you know, helping us and working with our other legislators, both at the state and federal level for this. Okay. I think that's all I have to say, and thank you very much.
Thank you. James Dudley.
James Dudley here. I've been a resident of Burlington County for well over 40 years. I've made my living doing mostly construction, infrastructure work, pipeline, bridge work, and stuff like that. I raised my children here. My grandchildren are being raised here. And I'd like to say a few things in favor of the pipeline. Probably this heat that we're enjoying right now in this building is coming from a pipeline. You know, pipeline construction, it makes a really nice boost to the economy. I witnessed it firsthand. Another thing, I've had the experience to work on a compressor station from the ground up. And the environmental standards and safety standards are very strict. Every phase of all the work, it's done right in front of professional inspectors, whether it be a welding inspector, electrical inspector, or environmental inspectors. As far as noise pollution, the walls of the compressor station, they're insulated, very quiet. Everything is state of the art for safety. I can't see there's any pollution that comes from a compressor station because the function of it, all it really does is just boost the pressure of the gas up to keep it moving. I mean, you know, there's like, them pipelines feed like all of New York City. It's a lot of people. There seems some people, they get misinformed. You know, they don't know the whole picture. But they're entitled to their opinion. So, you know, I'm in favor of the pipeline. Remember Local 172? We got about 3,500 men and women that, you know, we depend on projects like this for our livelihood. And that's about it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Agnes Marsala.
You guys don't allow presentations, do you?
No, we know this is public comment. We didn't find
out. Okay, some handouts for the committee members, the freeholders. I'm sorry. I'm Agnes Marcella, 68 Old York Road, Chesterfield, New Jersey. And I want to urge the freeholders to file a motion to intervene with the FERC, pursuant with the Code of Federal Regulations, Title 18, Chapter I, Subpart B, Section 385.214D, Grant of Late Intervention. Transco Williams tendered for filing revisions to its original application in response to a host of public comments from interveners and others to the FERC's environmental assessment. The additions and revisions were substantial and very late in the process, leaving inadequate time to respond. Now, I know you say that you have no stake in this, but as stewards of the residents of Burlington County, the freeholders are natural stakeholders in this matter. Bordentown's open space parcel is among the new revelations. This should be of utmost concern to you. This is taxpayers' money that went to this open space. It's in the middle of this compressor station. They do not have a, what is that word? That you don't grant them? Easement? And they're not gonna get one. So they're gonna have to go with them in the domain. And this is, again, taxpayers' money that paid for this land. The impact of drinking water due to the previously undisclosed proximity of wells to the compressor station is also a new addition, which you heard earlier. I also asked the freeholders to join others in halting the PennEast pipeline. PennEast is going to bring the unneeded gas to the compressor station in Burlington County. And I asked that you join with United States Representative Bonnie Watson Coleman, the 12th District, Leonard Lance of the 7th District, a Republican, along with State Senator Kit Bateman, also a Republican from Somerset, and Assemblywoman Elizabeth Maramahoa, in calling for the review of the proposed 1.2 billion PennEast gas pipeline to be halted after questions posed by federal regulators have gone unanswered. Again, you have a stakeholder in this, as you are a stakeholder in this, is it brings the gas to our county. And, you know, this SRL, this Southern Reliability Link, I can't even call it that. It's not reliable. It doesn't give me any reliability. I would just ask that you deny surveying rights to NJNG, to the county roads. I mean, that is something you can do. And please to grow, join the growing number of representatives who you heard listed tonight and other bodies and thousands of your constituents to do anything possible to slow down and hopefully stop this atrocity. And I would like you to heed the advice and good counsel of your own county engineer, Joseph Bickle. I mean, I know he wants to move it, but he doesn't like it where it is. That should be enough to just oppose it. And a word on job creation here. Today, I read something from The Nation from October 27, 2015, Mr. Robert Poland. And he says, for the United States, we found that increasing investments by around $200 billion per year to raise energy efficiency standards and expand clean, renewable production, about 1.2% of current gross domestic product, would drop U.S. emissions by 40% within 20 years. As you know, we are mandated, everyone is mandated, to try and drop emissions by what, 2050? It's coming up quick. While creating a net increase of 2.7 million jobs, this is after taking full account of the jobs that would be lost as coal, oil, and natural gas production fell by 40%. So another thing is, as workers well know, jobs in the dirty energy sector last only as long as there is coal, oil, or in this case, gas, to extract. The plan advanced by Mr. Pollan would generate millions of good jobs in the new cutting-edge and U.S.-based manufacturing sectors, and the levels of investment he calls for would stimulate sustainable economic growth. Most importantly, the investment plan proposed by Pollan would give working Americans new hope, and it would give our public institutions a positive new leadership role, from Congress to state legislators to local school boards. And the movement we need to reverse global warming needs to be led by Americans fueled by hope for a better life and new opportunities. That was today in the Huffington Post by Mr. Roger Hickey. So please help us. You can do something, and I beg you to do whatever you can. If you think you're powerless to affect change in these matters, then please tell me, why did you run for office? I'm not naive, but sometimes you have to put aside all the politicking, all the BS, and listen to that small, still voice inside you that lets you know you're human, that you're part of a community, a democracy that tells you you can make a difference, but only if you try. That's what we're doing. We're trying to make a difference. Please join us. Oppose both these projects, as well as the pennies. Thank you.
John Kopopinski, 950 Province Line Road, North Hanover Township. Thank you for the time tonight. Also a member of the Township Committee, North Hanover Township. What I have tonight, I've got a resolution from our meeting on January 21st, resolution 2016-34. Which was unanimously adopted by the committee, hand-delivered to say the postage on delivery.
There you go.
Okay. And what it is, it's opposing the compressor station. And I've been here before, and I'm just going to make it sort of a brief comment. And it's my opinion. The proposed compressor station and SRL pipeline, and you know this, would not provide natural gas service or benefits to any residents in North Hanover, Chesterfield, along the route of the pipeline. However, these residents would be forced to adverse environmental impacts and really the health safety risks posed by construction and operation of this project. And when I talk about the most important, really, and as I've always looked at it, public safety, health, and welfare is paramount. That's number one priority. God forbid something were to happen. Wish it never did. But if it did, if one person is injured, worse than, perhaps worse, we got to think about that, okay? There's got to be a different way to do this. So what I ask, personally, look at this, see if there's a way to do something to basically stop this project, okay? Thank you very much.
respond?
Broke it already.
It's leaking.
It's all right. It can be fixed. I don't know if you can see it or not, but I want to bring it because it kind of humanizes the real issue here about this compressor station. Can you see the houses? This is their blast radius. Can you see the homes? Can you see the schools? This is not politics. This is quality of life and human life. Now, we heard earlier about safety of these compressor stations. Then why have there been 10 fires and explosions in the last 4 years at compressor stations? How come they were fined by OSHA for not having followed safety procedures? This is not about politics. I think the fact that Democrats and Republicans have come out in direct opposition to this is something that you ought to take heed of. And it's, you know, it's, and I've been to other assembly people, I've been to one of the senator's office, I've been to a congressman's office. And quite frankly, it's very easy to say that, you know, this is not in our jurisdiction, this is not in our hands. But I think, as it was eloquently stated by Agnes, you represent us. Just as I need to stand up for my residents and try to protect them from the horrors of this thing, you need to stand up and protect us. It, you know, in Thanksgiving, we came before you. There was a large, right before Thanksgiving, you had a meeting. A lot of us came. I spoke the last time they were here. A lot of others spoke. We spoke out against not just the pipeline, and we didn't ask for an alternative, by the way, because guess what? The alternative does nothing to do away with the compressor station and its location. We asked you to say no to both. No to both. So that was Thanksgiving. So that was what? End of November? Well, it's now almost the end of January. Have you sent an objection to FERC about the compressor station? Have you attempted to intervene? Or have you had your representatives attempt to intervene? When you went to the BPU, did you, you know, you obviously were promoting your alternative line, which again does nothing for the compressor station. Look, folks, I mean, we can say it a thousand ways, and I don't want to repeat myself about all the horrors of this pipeline and how they leak, and they do leak, and compressor stations leak, and they leak poisonous gases. But in terms of jobs, the jobs here are very temporary. I think the net gain from this whole project is going to be 10 jobs. 10. No guarantee they're even going to be in our area. I don't call that a benefit. Short-term project, yes, and if I was, and I did, well, I was a union representative, so I can tell you, if I, my business as a business representative or as a union representative, my job is to go out and get employment for my people, you're darn right I'd fight for this, because that's what it would be. But I think you need to look on the long term. What is the impact of this? I want you to look down the line 40 years from now. We just had a tremendous problem with Superfund sites from garbage dumping in our state. We were number one in the country. Cost billions of dollars and they're still not all cleaned up. And who's paying for it? The companies who dumped their chemicals there? They pay a fraction. Who paid for it? We did. 40 years, that's what this thing is, 40 years. Do you really want to put on your children and your grandchildren the cost of cleaning up from this compressor station? Because I guarantee you, when it's done usable, they're going to walk away. We don't need it anymore. It's exceeded its life. We're gone. So who's going to get, you think they're going to remove it voluntarily? Mm-mm. They're going to be looking to us, JQ, taxpayer, to clean this up. In terms of need, I think we went through this before, but just to iterate, the only need that I can find, and it really is not a need that makes practical the expenditure of these kinds of funds, is a small portion of Lakehurst, which is on oil, that they would like to see on gas. That's it. Now, Fort Dix and McGuire are in Burlington County. Lakehurst isn't.
But that's just a small portion of it. And I think there are many other alternatives than spending billions of dollars on a pipeline that's going to pollute our neighborhoods and our residents. Yeah, look, everybody can go on the wrong track, and thank God we have time, we can reverse ourselves. We need you to come out and say no and to act upon it. We need you to write letters to FERC. We need you to take a stand and say this is not something that is needed in Burlington County. That's what we need. We need you to take a stand. Yeah, BPU's made their decision. Guess what? BPU doesn't turn down much when it comes from gas and oil. Take a look at their history. And FERC, 100% have approved.
Thanks.
So that's not the way to stop it.
Thank you, sir.
Stop.
All right, Jim. Belinda Blasek.
Hello, good evening.
Need an address.
Chesterfield? So I'm here concerning the pipeline and the compressor station. You were presented with the binder, and the binder was prepared by the citizens of the action group from the Responsible Pipeline. It was designed to provide you with pertinent information about these infrastructures. Some of the sections include resolutions passed opposing these projects. They were passed by Chesterfield Township, Mansfield, Bordentown, Upper Freehold. It also includes the transcript from the BPU hearing that was held on December 7th. Some of the statements included in that BPU transcript address safety and health impacts during construction, ongoing economic impacts for taxpayers, discussions that the pipeline is not for reliability, questionable whether the pipeline is a benefit for the joint base, as there is no guarantee that they are going to tie into it. Discussions that the fact that the proposed pipeline is going through two Superfund sites, so there is real concern of water contamination. This transcript reaffirms the project and the proposed route, or any route for that matter, doesn't make sense. News articles are included in this binder as well. There are local articles about specifically about the SRL pipeline and the compressor station. And in addition to that, there's national news articles evidencing adverse impacts related to natural gas or frack gas. I'm not gonna go on about the California. I think a few people have already mentioned that leak that's been going on since October 23rd and has caused over 3,000 families to be relocated and thousands more waiting. But the one thing no one mentioned is there was a newly constructed compressor station that became operational in 2015 that already exploded. So when the union worker gentleman was up here talking about all these inspections, I have concerns about that. Because if what he says is true, how did a new compressor station explode? There's also a fracking judgment awarded to a Texas family, the Parr family. Their last name is P-A-R-R. They were awarded $3 million for health effects that they sustained from fracked gas. In April 2015, $1.6 billion was awarded to the residents of San Bruno, California, for the gas explosion that occurred in 2010. And that explosion occurred where the gas company stopped short of repairing the pipeline. They actually deferred money from the safety fund and used it for bonuses and increases. So just kind of put that out there. We oppose both these projects for a number of reasons. We oppose them because of scheduled leaks called blowdowns, which, as you have already heard, release methane gas and a number of carcinogenic chemicals. We oppose them because of the real risk
and likely risk of explosion. We oppose them because of the tremendous environmental impact their installation will have on preserved land, the pine lands, and the clean air, the clean water supply. We oppose them because of the constant threat of accidental leaks and the potential for further environmental disaster. We oppose them because we have been reading headlines telling us that this is the warmest year recorded in human history. We have serious doubts about the longevity and the sustainability of this kind of dirty energy infrastructure. In regard to the forum held in Burlington on January 20th, where over 200 citizens gathered, I'd like to talk in particular about Assemblyman Herb Conaway. What he said was this: this is a test to see how government responds to the demands of people. So this is a test. I know that there are a lot of corporate interests in favor of these projects. The intersect of business and politics, corporate interests, and public good is not in any way a new circumstance for our country. In fact, oftentimes, it is a beneficial relationship. However, I believe this is a circumstance where the potential for harm far outweighs any potential for economic benefit. These projects may create a few temporary jobs, but they will create decades of health, safety, and environmental issues. I encourage you to stand with us and oppose the construction of both the compressor station and the pipeline. And I just want to make one last comment. Again, this is kind of related to the gentleman that was up here from the union who said that he worked at substations. The one thing he failed to mention, you know, when you work at these substations, and I got this from someone who I know that also works in the union, you can't take that dirt away. He failed to mention that. So maybe he could explain why they're not allowed to take that dirt away. And this is what they're going to put in our in our neighborhoods.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for the status, Engineer Berkeley, on the bridge. I wanted to ask when the New Jersey Transportation Trust Fund is funded, what is the process in terms of getting that into the budget? I saw in current budget you have a section in the back for capital improvement projects. So how does that work? That's held because you don't have the money, but how are projects prioritized and placed into the budget?
Mr. Berkeley?
Yes, we get money from the Transportation Trust Fund in two ways. We have local bridge future needs, which is a $25 million program. Each one of the counties gets $1 million, and the remaining $4 million is left to the discretion of the DOT. The other money we get every year is it's ADP money, which is based on an equation that's part of the state register, and it's calculated based on population and other things, centerline miles. And we get about $4.9 million a year, which the Freeholders have historically dedicated to our annual overlay program, which they in turn typically match the money that we get from DOT with regards to that. And then the other money is we have is our TIP money, which is our transportation improvement. And that's a program that takes a long time. We presently have about $30 million TIP for our 530 project, as well as Hanover Street Bridge Management Building.
I was also doing some research. I wanted to share this. Virginia Department of Transportation, they have done some different type of bridge replacement projects. So I'm not sure if Taylor Weissman and Taylor Works has a lot of different experience with truss bridges, but there's just some different options there. There's less than $21 million. I'm not sure what the traffic is on those bridges. I just want to present that. So I know we have the $21 million. I know that obviously is a lot of money, just trying to see something a little bit less for that. In terms of the traffic, I forgot to mention that last time. People still are complaining about that traffic with the bridge being closed, and I know you're talking about changing some of the lights and the signal timing.
I think we have changed some of the lights, but Joe?
Yes, we have modified the timing at the intersection of Crete and Center. We've had no reported accidents. Congestion has been, you know, it's the congestion is no different than what it was before when the bridge was open.
Okay. And another question I did have, just another concern, still the senior citizens, just to keep them in mind. You know, I've been advocating, asking people to write letters, but also just keep those residents in mind when you're talking to the various legislators, senators, reaching out to the governor. The seniors are actually really still having a really hard time getting on 295. The routes and alternatives they have to take because the bridge are closed, it's affecting their quality of life. And also the citizens in Willingboro and the ones that live right in Mount Laurel on the other side of the bridge, they are being affected. So while this bridge may not be used by everybody on the Freeholder Board, there are a lot of people in Willingboro, as well as Mount Laurel and other surrounding communities that use it, and it's very important. So I know you guys are working on it, but just realize everybody may not be here, but I'm here. They tell me, and they know I'm going to be here. So just realize it's really important, and on bridges, you know, it's very near and dear to me. So that's why I'm always here telling you guys about it. So I will see you in 2 weeks.
All right, at this point, we've gone through our list. Does any, sir, come on up. Name and address, please.
My name is Fred Laverne from Delanco, New Jersey. I live at 312 Walnut Street. The people behind me are the people that you represent. Three of you were addressed before the new year, specifically about taking an issue with the pipeline and the compressor station. Mr. Collins instructed you not to take a position on the basis that there was ongoing litigation. We asked for the docket number for the litigation that was promised to me by you, Mr. Garganio. I received a notice of an April 15th BPU hearing number. There was no litigation. Amy Bellegarde, then a freeholder sitting in that chair, put up her hand and said, we can take a position, and no one would second it, and unfortunately Ms. Schwartz was not present due to an illness. You three have a report card coming due. You, sir, this year, Ms. O'Brien and Mr. Donnelly, will be having their report card come due at the same time that the Assembly and the Senate are up for election in 2017. Mr. Gibbs and Mr. Peters.
You're getting the dates all wrong.
It doesn't matter. I'm going to go on and I'll speak. I realize normally you're just sitting over there playing with the phone again. Mr. Peters and Ms. Gibbs, you're new members to the board, okay? Everyone here is watching what you will do for the next 3 years. They expect you to take a leadership role over the next few years on the Freeholder Board. You know what these people want. You know what's right. The other three, unfortunately, those 30 pieces of silver have obviously been passed. I am more than disappointed. I am ashamed at the way that you are treating this community by not standing against this, and I mean the compressor station and the pipeline, not a reroute. Mr. Collins, I am horridly disappointed at your failure to tell the truth about a docket number.
Sir, the docket number was provided.
That's not a docket number. That is a hearing number, sir. That is not a civil litigation.
An administrative agency. It's litigation.
I asked you, said that's not litigation. That's a hearing, sir. Close card before striking university.
It was provided to you, sir.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm seeking the office of the gentleman that put these people here in September. If you want to get this stopped, I need your help. I'm Fred Laverne. I'm running for Congress in District 3 as the Democrat. Yeah. I need your help. Yeah.
My name is Vincent Carabin. I attend a few of these meetings.
Address, please. I'm sorry.
Oh, I'm sorry. 65 Fenton Lane, Chesterfield, New Jersey. I was here on the 25th, and I had asked the people that were present, freeholders, what their personal opinion was about this pipeline and the compressor station. The response I got was from Mr. Collins that, well, it's in litigation. Okay? All I wanted was a personal opinion. I put it aside thinking, well, if you're litigating, maybe you're going to help us. I went to the BPU meeting, which was that was December 7th. At that meeting, there were different attorneys that were introducing themselves. There was one gentleman, which I'd like to know when he was hired. by this board, and what he was paid. He got up and said he was representing Burlington County Freeholders, which I thought was great. There was a gentleman, a committeeman from Chesterfield sitting next to me. I said, terrific, we got somebody that's going to, you know, stand for us. When he did speak, he pretty much just said, everything's okay. The alternate route would be okay, or the route that we currently have. It's the compressor station, guys. I live a mile away, okay? I live a mile away from that compressor station where they're going to build it. I mean, I'm not that naive that this isn't going to go through. Everybody talks about FERC. FERC is 100% funded by the energy industry, 100%. There isn't like, well, you know, the government pays so much. No, it's 100%. So forget about FERC. The BPU, I watched a person testifying, another person from New Jersey Natural Gas, giving hand signals. Soon as there was a break, I went to the chairwoman. I said, are you allowed to prompt witnesses when they're on the hold? She said, oh, no. I said, well, she just turned around and walked away. She saw it. She was this far away. She saw that going on, nothing. So you knew it was a done deal. They passed it today. Guys, wake up. You got a congressman of MacArthur. He's got more money invested than any congressman. He's got $1.3 million in his portfolio with 41 different energy companies. So he's got vested interest. We're not getting any help from him. But that's a nickel and dime. That's what I call a nickel and dime, where a guy is feeding his portfolio by keeping his mouth shut. Guys, if you don't want to help us, that's fine. But spare everybody the ruse like you care, because you really don't.
So, I'm naive, but I'd like to get an answer from you tonight. When are you going to draft a resolution to say that you're either for what we've discussed tonight or against it? Because as a voting member, I want to know when I pull that lever what you decided. So you have, the time is now. So when will you draft? How does it come about? Who proposes it? Will you propose a resolution to your board, and will you take a vote internally? Can you explain that to me? How will that happen that you take a resolution that says we are opposed to the pipeline and to the compressor station? When does it happen? Is it something I make a motion from the floor that you make a motion, that
think,
you do?
I think the position of this board, it was in November when it was discussed, and it is the same as it is was before. Let me answer the question. And this is the exact the same thing that was expressed at that meeting, was that we were opposed to the route. We have an alternative route. If all the assembly folks and the people that want to stand up and fight this were helping in Trenton to push that alternate route through, it would get done.
Well, my point,
they're the ones that can control that. Energy would be done.
But you're
secondly, we are, and I think Freeholder Peters mentioned it today, is that that station is set up as a local home rule decision.
That's
your opinion.
Okay.
That is your opinion. And that is ours.
Things have changed. The board has changed membership. And now that you hear the things that are going on, right? You hear what's going on with the legislation. You hear that. So isn't it a team effort made with the local? You've heard the mayor speak, the township speak. Now the county has to, you know what you have to do? You have to shit or get off the pot. That's the bottom line.
I think we have told you what our position is.
As of today, I think we told you what our position is. Okay, so then my question
is. And our position hasn't changed.
Well, that means that three of you.
Well, they can speak for themselves.
What I'd like to know is how do we find out individually how you feel so it's a public record? That's what I want to know. Who am I voting for and who I'm not voting for? So how do you feel? How do you feel? You for it or against it?
We're not going to go up and down the line.
Okay, but you just asked me.
No, I didn't. I said a freeholder comment. The freeholders can comment on anything, and they can express their opinion if they wish to.
Do you wish to express your opinion, Mr. Peters?
This is not a court of law, and that question will not be. You can talk, and it's public comment.
Does he want to express his opinion?
Well, you're not asking questions. You can express your comments.
Okay.
This isn't a court of law.
But didn't you just say to me that they
could express... No, I said they have the ability if they wish to, not to be prompt by you or asked by you.
Okay. I'll remember that.
Please do.
You did a lousy job. Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah.
Lousy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
on Sheridan, Chesterfield, New Jersey. If we're talking about home base, that road they want to go down is your home base. That is your road. It is the county road. It is not the township's road. That's first things first. Second thing, since you sit behind those desks, let me inform you. These union workers want to put this pipeline down there. It's going right past a cemetery, a Quaker cemetery that is holding a General Senator Abraham Tillett. If people aren't supposed to rest in peace, why are we burying them to begin with? I don't think you would want a pipeline going through your loved one's cemetery. I don't think you would want it going through your backyard. It's going to go past a national historic place. Why do we even register if that's the case? All this matters to you, it doesn't, because it matters to us, because we have to live with the effects. You guys sit behind your desk and do whatever you want while we're going to suffer the consequences. And the union back there is going to tell you that they're for it, and that's fine. But I've spoken to the union. They don't go by seniority. So all these older guys back there, you guys can think what you want, but it goes by who's more qualified. That's number one. Second thing is, the lawyer already said for Transco that they're only going to take one, maybe two people out of the union to do a temporary job. And we're left with that. Second thing is, are you going to pay the difference in our police salary when our taxes go down, when our property values go down? Are you going to be the ones answers to a person that says, oh, well, we're sorry, we couldn't get you to the hospital in time. Sorry, your husband died from a heart attack because we didn't have enough funding. That's exactly what's going to happen, but you don't care because you sit behind this desk and it doesn't affect you. But as a human being and as a taxpayer and as a person that votes, at the end of the day, I will not vote any one of you in, and I don't care what stand you take, I don't want to hear it. Because you've said it by actions speak louder than words, you've said it.
Yeah.
And you want to talk about home base? That county road is your property, you have the right to put a stop to it. And that's home base, not ours.
Good evening. My name is Patty Kronheim. I'm from Hopewell Township, New Jersey. And you might be wondering, what am I doing down here? Well, I'm with Hopewell Township Citizens Against the Pennies Pipeline. And I'm also with a new campaign formed by the Pinelands Preservation Alliance, New Jersey Conservation Foundation, as well as the Stony Brook Millstone Watershed, a campaign called Rethink Energy New Jersey, where we're looking at the energy issues in New Jersey, we're looking at data, we're collecting research, and we're doing our research. And I'd like to share some of that with you tonight, just to have some things cleared up. And I do thank you for the opportunity to speak, and I also thank you that you, Freeholder Peters, that you did say that you are not approving the compressor station. That is a step in the right direction, so we'll start there. So why did this group form in the first place? It's because really there are three separate projects, and it's one project. It's one project from Holland Township down, all the way down to the end of the Southern Reliability Link, masquerading as three separate projects. So nobody looks at all of the impacts on water, the impacts on air. Okay, and that's really important. And that's why there is bipartisan opposition all along the line. Every town along the Pennies line, the Hunterdon County, which, you know, is a Republican county, okay? Hunterdon County and Mercer County have written resolutions opposing the Pennies pipeline, asking to look at cumulative impacts, writing into FERC. So it would be very good and it would be very timely for you all to get on board with what's going on around the state. This is not an isolated issue. This is a statewide onslaught of these pipelines coming in, pushing New Jersey in the wrong direction. Now, we all want jobs, right? We all want jobs. We all want clean energy, reliable energy. And we all want clean air and water. I think we all have that in common, right? So I just want to say something about jobs. Renewables and energy efficiency produce 3-to-1 jobs over fossil fuel jobs. So every time you hear about one job being created for dollars spent for a fossil fuel project, it really represents a 2-job loss. And there is a multi-million dollar economy that is revving up right now with renewables and energy efficiency that New Jersey is going to miss the boat on. We are going to miss the boat economically. We will not be part of this renewable revolution. And it is a real shame for anyone who wants long-term jobs, because these fossil fuel pipeline and compressor station jobs are short-term, they're very small, and they're mostly supplied by out-of-state workers. And in the Pennies pipeline, it's 10 permanent jobs. That's it. It's really a shame. In terms of health, well, the industry itself says that acceptable emissions of gas pipelines from birth to end, from cradle to grave, is 6-8%. And these are measured in tons. The amount of emissions are measured in tons, okay? and that's from fugitives, fugitive emissions, planned blowdowns, and accidents. I have a letter from a woman who lives in the compressor station up in Lawrenceville that's being expanded. That would be the top of the Garden State expansion, and it's very similar to the compressor station that they want to build down in Chesterfield. And she talks about her son's nosebleeds, the time she's had to evacuate her home. She talks about how loud it is, that even with the windows down a quarter mile away, they can hear it. These are real impacts, and how every night, the last sentence is, it's impossible for me to forget that my family and I live near a very dangerous facility, which is left unmanned every evening. These are real risks that your community members are going to have to endure. And it's not a joke. It's not speculative. These are real things that happen by a compressor station. It's the one that their Transco's already built can show. The other piece that's important with health, just to pull out one, is benzene. It's a VOC. It's a very toxic carcinogen that is emitted from all compressor stations. All compressor stations in the country emit this. And the part, 14 parts per billion, at 14 parts per billion of benzene. And that's if you took 14 marbles, to be denied that, you put it in a swimming pool full of marbles, okay? That's what 14 parts per billion is. So it's not much. At that amount, 1 in 10,000 people will develop leukemia. To bring that on a personal level, you know, who would that be? Someone you know? A child? You know, a spouse? That's the actual EPA facts on benzene, and there's a lot of research on it. So they're very real, concrete risks with compressor stations. And the last thing I'd like to say is simply to clarify the BPU hearing today. They did rule today. But what the BPU did was they took the SRL line, Southern Reliability Line, and they split it into two separate dockets. Now, one docket is this general docket, and that's the one they ruled on today. And we don't know exactly why they created that docket, because that one doesn't have the public hearing and input or the legal briefs filed. The other one has all the hearings coming and the legal briefs that were filed on Friday by Pinelands Preservation Alliance, New Jersey Ratepayer, by North Hanover, Plumstead, Chesterfield. There are legal actions pending. So that part of the docket is not ruled on. So this is very much alive, and I want you all to understand that difference. And one of the biggest things that was mentioned in the opening brief is some research from an association called Skipping Stone, which Rethink Energy helped create some of that research and fund that. But it actually shows, and Skipping Stone is a DC firm that is one of the most respected firms on modeling for energy modeling in the country, and it's the one that FERC respects the most. They said that the Southern Reliability Link's argument about reliability is a sham, and it's going to present a massive burden shift onto ratepayers and increase rates. So economically, this is a bad idea. So I'm asking you, please, to take this opportunity to stand up, support the communities, pass a resolution against the Garden State expansion, against the Southern Reliability Link, join other counties in doing this, and support your communities, add your voice to this fight.
Thank you.
Health piece
just pass it on.
That was done by Hopewell Township that you can all do, and if you want to have your town do a Board of Health on compressor stations, please do.
Thank you very much.
Mayor Jill Popko, I am the mayor of Burlington Township, 3 Henry Marshall Drive, Burlington Township. This meeting is disturbing, to say the least. Honestly, you've stated here today that you haven't endorsed this project, but by fiat, you have. Yet, your inaction and not stating opposition is an endorsement. You've heard that over and over again here. Now, I can't tell you how disappointing this is. You must not possibly live anywhere near this pipeline or compressor station, or you wouldn't be so cavalier. I honestly just can't believe it. Here we are, January 20th, we had this forum, you heard about it. At that forum were a number of elected officials. It was bipartisan in opposition, where they will be doing legislation to hopefully stop these projects. I am so sorry to say that not one of you attended that forum. You didn't even bother to RSVP or send a representative to hear your constituents' concerns. So basically, what you are saying is you endorse this project. Next, today there was a phone call to a resident in my town, actually to some residents, by your communications director. Your communications director made it personal. He attacked my character. I find it offensive and disgusting. You can smile and think it's funny, but it's not. It's offensive. This is not about personal. This is not about politics. This is about the well-being and the health and goodwill of what is happening in your county that you, each of you, is representing. It is absolutely not a political game here that we are playing. There are people in my community that are directly affected by this compressor station. Our schools are directly affected. We've got churches directly affected, and we have a child care center directly affected. That you can't spend a few minutes to throw up a resolution opposing this is unbelievable. It really is. Now, the accusations by Eric Arpertz to the residents were not true, that he made upon my character. In particular, these commentary that today here that you're not opposing or you're not endorsing this project is outrageous. I have to disagree on all accounts. You ask, what can you do? Well, there's permits that have been filed to take our wetlands in Burlington Township in Chesterfield. The NJDEP has just approved that, to have this poisonous and degrading our environment pipeline and compressor station put in. You can appeal that. You've got 30 days from the day it's published to appeal that permit. There's a step in the right direction. Right there. Very simple. Now, we don't see you appealing that or sending a letter to FERC. Well, guess what? Here we are again. You're endorsing this project. So don't say you're not endorsing it until you take action. And that is what we're asking. Action. Now, I have a question for you specifically. I was at that BPU meeting, and your attorney was there. Can you answer this question? Did your attorney oppose the SRL pipeline at that meeting?
I'm sure you opposed the route, not the pipeline itself.
Exactly. You never opposed it. Thank you. So endorsing it is exactly where we're at. Thank you very much. Shameful. Each and every one.
Hear, hear.
Tonight is very, very sad. Playing a lot of politics. And again, people have said, it's not about politics, it's about lies. Okay? The next time something happens, I don't care whether it's a pipeline or whether it's another 9/11, I don't want to hear anything from any of you, because you're telling me tonight that you don't care about lies. That's scary, because someday you're going to have somebody that you're going to need, and they're going to look at you and they're going to say, you didn't care, why should I care? You got to start thinking about that. You really do. Now, as far as not doing what you should have done opposing this pipeline, that's one thing. It's another thing. There's a group of gentlemen in the back of the room. They're union workers. You haven't done anything for them. They're good, hard-working men who need to put food on the table. And you're saying to them, take temporary jobs that are dirty. Push for cleaner jobs. Clean energy will give them long-term jobs. We'll let them put better meals on their tables. You're not doing anything for them. You're not doing anything for yourselves. One of you smirked before at something Jill said. That was extremely offensive, not just to Jill, to all of us. It tells us what you think of us. I think you want us to have a better outlook on you. So think about that before you smirk again. Also, for the union workers, if you really want to know about how good the jobs are through NJNG, you can go to your union brothers and sisters at IBEW 1820, and they'll tell you they're not that great. So I'm not going to say anything more about it. You have another way to look at it. So it's sad. It's sad in this place because nobody ever says, oh, look, we took a seat on this committee and we can make a difference and we can help people. I just get these looks at me and smirks at me. It doesn't make anybody feel more comfortable. It's dangerous to lives, houses, to economy. If you're in politics, if you're on a committee, you're going to be worried about economy. That's part of the job. So, you know, I'm not trying to be nasty. I know I come across nasty. I'm a native New Yorker. Maybe I'm nasty. I don't know. I'm just saying that, you know, we hear it over and over and over again. Oh, if the people had just worked together better. And then when you're actually thrown in front of it, everybody goes in their own direction. You know, it's happening on this level of politics. It's happening on the bigger level of politics. And everybody is complaining, but nobody is saying, all right, let's work together. Now, I don't know. Standing back there, I go up. Yeah. What are these people trying to tell me? Are they trying to tell me that if they were in Flint and there was an infant dying of lead poisoning, they'd say, not my infant? That's really horrible for me to have even thought of that. Almost inhuman to have thought of that. That's the impression you're giving. I don't want any of you to give that impression. I am assuming that you two are humans. that someday you're going to need help from each other. And now's the time to do it. Come together. Put in a proposal. Help people. That's what the job is all about. When you took a public service job, it was about helping others. Each and every one of you up there is going to feel more complete when you actually do the job of helping others. Help the union guys get better jobs. Help the people who are in harm's way. Help your environment. Help your economy. Help people who don't know where to turn right now because they're about to lose their homes. And people look at me like I'm crazy, but the value of homes go down. If all your money is in your home, then are you guys going to fund us when we have to go bankrupt? I don't think so. All I'm saying is before it's too late, get your act together. That's all. I'm not trying to be nasty. Think of your environment. Think of your economy. Think of your people. Think of what the future holds for you. And the future holds a lot for you. You've got the key to the future in your hand. Right now, you're in a very odd place. Clean energy is coming up. The old energy is going down. You're stuck in the middle. You don't know which way to go. Do your research. And bring in a better future. That could be your legacy. Don't let not caring about other people be your legacy.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Cindy Bennett. I live at 420 Chesterfield Jacobstown Road, Chesterfield, New Jersey. I'm just looking at you all. I'm not sure whether it's going in or whether you don't care. And I'm hoping I'm wrong, okay? I've been a resident of Burlington County for over 50 years. I've seen all the destruction that's going on in California. I see, you know, hear about all the explosions and everything else. This is going to be built where I've grown up. This will not benefit Burlington County. It will not benefit the residents of Burlington County. It won't benefit the residents of counties that are going to be involved in this as well. The compressor station is very unhealthy and dangerous. It will not provide jobs. It will not ensure safety for the residents. Health, blast area, water. It will affect the soil on farmlands. It will affect historical areas. It will run right past the Veterans Cemetery where my uncle and my father are buried. The problems farmers are trying to farm, and they're trying to get to their fields and market their produce, and the roads are going to be all torn up. This is going to cause a problem. The residents trying to get to different places due to road construction, emergencies, not being able to get somewhere. Compressor station, New Jersey, and the New Jersey Turnpike, again, emergencies. And the blast zone, what happens to that road? I don't know. It's very disturbing. Regardless of whether you say you have control over this decision of the pipeline and the compressor station, you are here to watch over us and to help us and protect us, is what my understanding is of Burlington County Freeholders. I'm asking you to please stop the compressor station. Please stop the pipeline. Please oppose it. I don't know what else to say, because if you don't do that, then what's running through my head is, what do they have vested in this? If they're not, if it's not going to invest, if it's not going to support you or do anything, do you have a financial investment in this, these companies, or in something? Do you have the Christie? Is he wanting you to do something, or is he promising you something? That's what's running through my head when I'm seeing that you're not protecting our county. This is your county. This is my county. This is our county. Please, all I'm asking you to do is oppose this. Stop it completely. Thank you.
My name is Christopher Bulkey. I live at 12 Panama Road, Chatsworth, New Jersey. It's in Burlington County. And I'd like to say right off the bat that I'm in favor of this pipeline. And for the record, you represent me too, equally as everybody else here. I'm a resident of Burlington County. And I have many other friends that are in favor of this pipeline, that are residents of Burlington County, that you represent. You represent everybody of Burlington County, not just a select group that's here today. I'd also like to state that I'm also a member of the International Union of Operating Engineers, Local 825. I live in Chatsworth. There is no natural gas in Chatsworth. Everybody heats their house. I'd say 95% of the people heat their house with home heating oil. Home heating oil is stored in tanks, for the most part under the ground, and it leaks. And that creates an environmental hazard, far worse than natural gas. Natural gas everybody keeps saying it leaks. The pipes are tested. They don't leak unless somebody hits it, okay? I would also like to state that you say there's no need for natural gas. There are new houses being built every single day and on property. The houses down in Seaside alone are being torn down and doubled in size, mostly all gas down there for heat. There's a need for natural gas. There was a statement made about heating houses, about providing heat from the ocean, the temperature of the water on the top to the water on the bottom. If we were to use that system, I would like to know how many miles of pipe it would take to heat the homes of 8 million people in the state of New Jersey doing that system instead of this system. I'd also like to state about natural gas for people that all of a sudden it becomes a dirty word. Natural gas was first used in the United States in 1821. In 1843, the iron pipe was invented. Pipelines have been in the United States for over 150 years. There was also statements about training people that work on pipelines. People who work on pipelines are highly trained. Our local 825, covers the entire state of New Jersey. We have our own training facility, which is currently conducting pipeline training for our members. We have over $5 million worth of equipment currently at our training facility providing for this training. The International Union of Operating Engineers, which is nationwide, conducts pipeline training every year. This year alone, the International will conduct 178 classes of training all over the United States for a total of 150,000 man hours of pipeline training. Believe me when I tell you, the people on pipelines are trained. It's about the jobs. The jobs stay local. In our union, anybody on a machine, 67% at a minimum of all operating engineer jobs on any pipeline in the state of New Jersey will be filled by members of Local 825. That's local jobs to local people. There was talk about temporary jobs, that these jobs are just temporary. A pipeline goes 6 months. Every construction job is temporary. This building was built, they're gone. They're not here. There's guys working outside.
Demit to us.
Oh, sorry. Guys are working outside. They're doing some upgrade. They'll be gone in a couple months. That's a temporary job. My last job started on Sunday plowing up in Newark, New Jersey for snow removal. It ended today. That was temporary. That's the way it works. All construction jobs are temporary. As far as substations, there's a lot of comments about the substations that are incorrect. Someone said about the dirt is contaminated, taken away. Any substation, dirt does not leave the site. The site gets cordoned off, fencing, silt fence. That dirt does not leave the site.
Everybody got an opportunity to talk. It was respectful. Let's keep it that way and finish it off that way.
That's FERC's rules. Does not leave the site. Also, as far as compressor stations, the federal government, the DOT, Department of Transportation, is what regulates pipelines. They have put in a series of upgrades for a better lack of a, it's kind of like the gas mileage for cars. Every couple of years, there's got to be upgrades. This is all done by the DOT, not by the gas company. They're making the gas company, DOT is making the gas company do these compressor station upgrades. And I would just like to state, with all these comments about the dirt in the compressor station and the work on the pipeline, I don't know how these people know this without working on a pipeline. How can anything that they say be credible if they have not worked on a pipeline? How would they know? You can't read it from the Huffington Post, I can tell you that.
Thank you very much.
That's it?
Yes, sir. How was your time? And we're going to do one more.
Hi, my name is Virginia Monson. I live at 11 Winding Brook Road, Bordentown, New Jersey. I'd just like to ask each of you, do you read the emails that you receive from your constituents, everyone here? Do you read them yourselves, or do you have other people read them? I'm asking them. Do you respond to your constituents?
Usually staff does that.
The staff does. Do either of any others here?
That's standard practice.
That you all read your emails? All right. Mr. Peters, I've been watching you throughout. You look as though you need toothpicks to hold your eyes open. You have been looking everywhere else. Ms. O'Brien, you have been looking down. Mr. Gargania, you have had smirks.
I'm writing notes.
I hope they're notes. I hope any of you are not sitting there with cell phones and looking down and texting. Someone up here, their phone has been ringing. And I saw you pick your cell phone up.
That's a timer, man.
It's a timer.
Okay.
There's 5 minutes of time.
All right. My next question. I lived in Piscataway in the 1980s. There was
a gas explosion at one of the pipes in Edison itself. I lived in within 1 mile, and I felt my house rock. That was a gas explosion in a pipe. It was not a gas explosion from a compressor. It was felt. It was damaged. There were apartment houses that were damaged. Fortunately, no one was killed. This can happen here. Do you know how many people live within that radius? Do you know how much contamination is going to come from it? Do any of you live near there? Do you worry about us people? Do you worry about your constituents? Or don't you care? I think each of you need to examine your conscience, because each of you could have a loved one who was affected by this. Think about it. Thank you.
I'm not here for the pipeline. I'm here. Sorry. We do have renewables in our park grant, but I'm here about a park grant that my municipality is applying for. I'm a teacher and I work in municipal recreation programs in the summer. And we recently applied for a park grant, which I know is going to be before you guys in two weeks. Yeah. And I want to come and just talk about the support of the game that I'm teaching. It's a game called pickleball. I don't know if anybody's familiar with it, but it's played by seniors and younger children. I say younger, 15 and under, high school and under. It's a game that's kind of exploding here. I served as the United States pickleball ambassador 10 years ago. And this is a true story. 10 years ago when I went to do a pickleball tournament, the only one offered in the Northeast was at a nudist colony. Now it's a game where it's played in Cherry Hill Racquet Club, Marlton Fieldhouse. We have courts for kids and seniors to play, like temporary style courts. What we're applying for is like full-time dedicated pickleball courts, and it would be definitely the only one like it in the Camden, Burlington County where I play.
Which town?
Gainesport.
Okay, there were two towns.
Morristown, I think, is also applying or has applied for something, but this is a little different. Actually, the lady's doing that, Denise Donald. She's the current representative for the United States Pickleball Association. She has, I can't tell you the exact number, but 100 or so people that play regularly just in the Morristown, Cherry Hill, Gainesport kind of area. Medford camps have picked it up. It's a game that, this is what I think the best part is, I have young kids getting into sports now. Like the cost of sports is, it's crazy to be on like a travel team, a local team. But this is a game that you can play for $50 to buy a paddle and you're okay for 3 or 4 years. And we need things about as the seniors upload videos on how to play the game, and kids watch them. So like, it's almost like the seniors have embraced this technology, and my students, I can say, well, you're having this problem, check out this video, and somebody from Florida will have a video up that they can read a drill off of. It's kind of like a neat way, like seniors have embraced the technology, and the kids are obviously oriented. So just hope when you read the grants, like you see that one, and you just don't ask me if it's a pickleball court made out of pipelines, because I don't know if I could. Thank you.
Thank you.
Michael Galenda. Galenda. G-O-L-E-N-D-A. 1610 Albert Street, Gainesport, New Jersey.
All right, at this point, we'll move on. Thank you, sir. Thank you. We'll move on to comments from Freeholders. Freeholder Peters.
Yes, thank you, Director. I want to thank everybody for coming out tonight, and know that your comments, I mean, we made it to about, everybody's still here, almost 9 o'clock. I appreciate your comments, so we'll be taking that into consideration. Thank you.
Freeholder O'Brien.
I also very much want to express how much I do listen to every single thing that is said, and I take many notes. I take it all to heart. As Director Gargano said, we did intervene. When we heard about this, we did intervene. It's easy to immediately say no, but what we did was we came up, spent many hours, much engineering time to look for an alternate route, thinking that would be a better way. So much time was spent, much consideration was given, and is still being given. We are still in an intervening status. We still oppose the route. So we are, you know, we're in a position where it's up to the BPU to choose the route. So we are doing everything we can in the best way that we can. So we appreciate you coming. We do listen to everything you say, and we are doing whatever we can in this instance.
Does that mean it's going in? Freeholder Donnelly?
Nothing, Director, thank you.
Freeholder Gibbs?
Nothing, Director, thank you.
And I am pretty talked out tonight, but we do appreciate you folks coming out, and we do listen to you, and we appreciate your opinions. Looking for a motion to adjourn.
So
motion by Freeholder Peters, second by Freeholder O'Brien. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Aye.